Lab-grown meat has a problem. People can't decide what to call it.
In vitro meat.
Cultivated meat.
Cultivated meat.
Test tube burger.
Lab meat.
Schmeat.
Cellular agriculture.
For Anthony Shore, whether it's a product or a company, the name can be everything.
Every time you think of a company, you think of their name. It's one of the most important assets that a company has, if not the most important asset.
And with at least one product now approved for the sale in the US and billions invested worldwide, a big question remains for meat grown in machines. What the heck do we call this thing?
This is LabMade, a series about an industry challenging the way we think about food and whether it can live up to its promise of changing the world. Subscribe to our channel for more videos like this one.
Lab-grown meat might be a new technology, but the idea's been around for a while. Here's what Winston Churchill wrote in an essay which touched on, among other topics, the future of food. We shall escape the absurdity of growing a whole chicken in order to eat the breast or wing by growing these parts separately under a suitable medium. That was 1931. He went on to use the word synthetic to describe this future food category, which he thought would be reality by 1981. I guess we're a bit behind schedule. Since 2013, when the world's first lab-grown hamburger was created, companies have been brainstorming what to call this product. There was Kraft meat, frankenmeat, carne de laboratorio, shiguanrou.
It's a category that's populated by many different companies and doing many different things. There's no clear consensus yet that has emerged for a standardized descriptor for this category.
This is Anthony Shore.
Come on in.
If you've heard of Fitbit or Dreyer slow-churned ice cream before, it's because of him. He's been a professional namer for decades, and words are his thing.
My favorite book as a kid was The Dictionary. I love word games, but I'm terrible at Scrabble, which is not what anyone expects.
When he works with clients, it takes just under 2 months and about 2,000 choices to come up with one good name.
Sometimes the job of a name is to get attention. Sometimes the job of a name is to communicate something clearly. Sometimes it's to tell a story.
And he's looking for
certain phonetic or phonological patterns, what their underlying definition is, differentiated but relevant names.
What to call lab-grown meat has been mostly left up to the scientists and the companies making it. Here's a chart showing how different names have appeared in books over the last few years. At first, there were more scientific terms like in vitro, which is when you tinker with cells outside its animal context.
None of these terms really travel into the world of consumers very easily, and they also require a certain amount of technical and scientific background for them to feel familiar.
For some time, the word cultured, which describes growth of animal cells in an artificial environment, became a popular choice. There were also attempts at cell-based meat.
I think that it was neither very appealing to consumers nor very helpful. Of course, all meat is cell-based if you zoom in far enough.
This is Chris Bryant. He did a study a few years ago on how people reacted to some of these names. Lab-grown was associated with unnaturalness and disgust, while animal-free made participants think of vegetarianism, which is working against lab-grown meat companies' attempt to win over carnivores. Clean meat was positively received as connoting healthy and natural. The term was actually coined to suggest the environmental benefits of cultivated meat. But it ruffled the feathers of traditional meat companies. Some thought it implied their meat was dirty. When it comes to the name, the traditional meat industry was also put off by another thing. Not the descriptors, but the word meat itself. Starting from 2018, bills were introduced in 24 US states, many of which had large cattle industries, to restrict the use of the word meat for anything other than meat that's taken from a slaughtered animal.
I want my ribeye steak to have been walking around on 4 feet at one time or another.
This was mostly targeted at the plant-based industry, which actually had products on the shelves and posed a bigger threat at the time. One example is Louisiana, where in 2020, it became illegal to use meat-related terms like burger or sausage to describe plant-based foods. The law also preemptively excluded lab-grown meat from being called meat. The name debate isn't just in the US. In the last few years, countries like France and South Africa have tried to ban the use of meaty words for plant-based products. Turkey went a step further by banning plant-based cheese altogether.
The usual argument for that has been that they might be misleading. Consumers might purchase these plant-based products and under the false apprehension that they're buying a meat product. To be frank, I don't think that that argument is made in particularly good faith.
At least in the US, legislation may have started because of plant-based protein, but it was lab-grown meat that spooked traditional meat producers.
The potential for cell-based meat, which, you know, looks and quacks and smells and tastes like a duck, literally, if you're talking about duck meat, is more likely consumers to think that it's actual a slaughtered animal.
The preferred term adopted by American lobbying groups like the National Cattlemen's Beef Association, lab-grown fake meat. This gets at bigger questions about why and how we use names. Should they just be accurate descriptors or also serve as juicy marketing material or help protect economic interests at stake?
Is the fact that it wasn't a slaughtered animal, is that even material to consumers, right? Should you have to tell them?
Even as the industry is coming to terms with a name, people's willingness to try lab-grown meat varies pretty widely. Surveys suggest as low as 25% in Australia, but around 70% in three Chinese cities. And regardless of what it's called, factors like safety, price, and taste will be essential to the success of lab-grown meat. According to one study, a kilo of lab-grown meat currently costs about $63 to produce. This chicken burger at Supermeat, which is a lab-grown meat company in Israel, did taste better than the one I had in the McDonald's across town.
Thank you very much.
But it was five times the price.
The name, the descriptor is everything and it's nothing. You know, every time we think of it, we'll think of that descriptor. But a lousy product is never going to succeed, no matter what the descriptor is. Hopefully a great descriptor will keep appeal and interest.
Thanks for watching. Our LabMate series is looking at an industry that's challenging the way we think about food. If you haven't checked out our previous episodes, click down here. And stay tuned for our next video on lab-grown chocolate.